Good morning, everyone. This is Archbishop Richard Gagnon here in Winnipeg, Manitoba at the Catholic Center. This is our Friday morning report, and thank you very much for joining us. It is December the 8th today, the Solemnity of the Immaculate Conception. I'll talk about that in a few moments as we go through our Friday report. But as I mentioned last time, we've begun our Friday reports once again. It's an opportunity for your bishop to reach out to the people in the Archdiocese about certain questions, concerns, events that are occurring in the diocese, and it's always good to communicate. So I think, first of all, one of the concerns that has come my way, and that is simply over the question of the synods in the plural, because there's some confusion, I find, among some people about the synod. We've had an archdiocesan synod in the Archdiocese of Winnipeg a few years ago, and then, of course, there's a lot of talk in the media about another synod, and that is the General Synod, or the Universal Synod, that is being held in Rome. Actually, it just finished. There are two sessions, this last October and next year in October. So there's two basic synods we're talking about, but they are related. Now, our Archdiocesan Synod finished a few years ago, and just for a reminder, you'll see on the screen a picture of the pastoral letter or the post-synodal exhortation that I wrote in conjunction with a committee that summed up our synod experiences, and it also brings forth the various propositions of our synod. And that's available on the website, and it's good to look at that. I find a lot of people haven't looked at it. All the propositions are there, the recommendations from the synod are in that pastoral letter, Disciples on the Way. And the second synod is the one in Rome that the Holy Father called, and that is on the theme of synodality. And you know, I think part of the confusion has been that the dioceses of the world have all participated in that synod insofar as, in the last couple of years, sending feedback forward so that that synod in Rome could occur. So we had listening sessions in the archdiocese, we had people responding and giving information and feedback, as all the dioceses in the world did. But they are two distinctive synods. But on the other hand, they are related to one another, because what we did in the diocese prior to the pandemic will be in some way enhanced by the findings of this universal synod. So just to sum up that bit of a confusion that exists, and you might be interested in knowing also that the statistics show that two-thirds of all of the dioceses in the world have never had a synod. And so we are part of the one-third, and it has been a very enriching experience for us. Let me read you something Pope Francis said. He said, "It is not enough to have a synod. We must become the synod," right? So that's very telling, actually, because a synod is a way of being church, and it's a very ancient way of being church, as it was in the first year, among the early Christians. And so it is something we must take to heart and become part of the way we function as the Archdiocese of Winnipeg. So going forth now to the Universal Synod, a couple points just to clarify that, to maybe bring some clarity to this a little bit. First of all, the Synod on Synodality, which the Holy Father called, is really a fulfillment of the direction and the perspective of the Second Vatican Council in the 1960s. You'll see on the screen right now, and I've got my computer here to help me, and if I make a mistake, please forgive me, because I'm not technologically minded at all. A renewed reception of Vatican II, right? The synodal path is, in fact, implementing what the Council taught about the Church as mystery and the people of God called to holiness. It values the contribution of all the baptized, etc., etc. You can read that yourself. One of the things about a computer, you can pause it and you can read the actual information on the screen. So it's a renewal, it is a fulfillment of the Second Vatican Council and building an image of synodality, rather building a culture of synodality in the church, throughout the whole church. Now, who participated? Well, that's interesting because there were 365 participants in October that went to Rome. Many people thought that I went to Rome. I didn't go to Rome on that. I was involved on this side of the Atlantic, but there were 365. You'll see on the screen right now a wonderful photograph taken in the Paul VI Hall in the Vatican. Those are all of the delegates with the Holy Father standing, are sitting in the middle. That's the beautiful bronze of the resurrected Christ behind them there, okay? It's called a family photo of the delegates who participated. Now, what kind of people participated in that? You'll see on the screen right now another image of the categories of people, 365 participants, patriarchs and major archbishops of the Eastern churches, bishop delegates of the Episcopal conferences, etc., etc. There were priests, deacons, religious, laity, women, youth, 10 from each of the 7 continental regions, and so on. You can read that yourself. It's quite a gamut of people who participated in that synod. Now, what about our Canadians that went to the synod? People ask me, you know, which Canadians went? Who in fact went? Well, you'll find on the screen right now, you'll find a photograph of the Canadian participants. And there they are. My print is rather small, so I'm leaning towards my screen if you don't mind. But you'll see there Cardinal Gerald Lacroix, who is the primate in Canada, Archbishop of Quebec, the president of the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops, William McGrattan. You see also Bishop Raymond Poisson, who was the past president. You'll see Archbishop Michael Miller, Vancouver. You'll see Bishop Marc Pelchat, also from Quebec. Linda Strout is there. She's a lay person involved in the church. Sister Chantal Desmarais is there also. There is Sammy Aoun and Catherine Clifford and Gilles Routier and Jean Vizina, who is the secretary of the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops. And so these were the Canadian participants in the synod. Now, why was the participation of the synod expanded, right? Normally, universal synods held in Rome are composed of bishops only, and a synod really is a matter of the bishops. But you must remember in the Second Vatican Council that lay people, lay advisors and experts were also involved in that as well, not to the same extent. But you have an image on the screen right now that says, why expand participation in the synod in Rome? Why so many lay people? Why so many other people from around the world, from different cultures and backgrounds and so on and so forth? It says here that lay people, religious priests and deacons were witnesses of a process that intends to involve the whole church. So, you know, in your parish, the parish priest represents your archbishop, right? And the bishop ultimately has responsibility for teaching in the archdiocese and for, you know, governing the archdiocese. But you'll notice in a parish council that there are the parishioners involved because decision-making has a vertical and a horizontal aspect. And so the synod is the work of the bishops, but in the consultation of the baptized and the involvement in the baptized for their perspective, their expertise, and all of that. And since we are dealing with the question of synodality, it is only right that it would be expanded in that particular way. And also, too, I mentioned in our Archdiocesan Synod the importance of the baptized, the sense of the faith, the sensus fidelium, the people of God. Within the people of God, there is a certain authority and discernment that is important for the whole church. But it must also be connected with the magisterium of the church at the same time. And you'll see on the screen there a little description of what we mean, the sense of the faith, right? It's not hard to understand. in Korea and Japan and even in Russia under the communists, when there were no churches, when there were no missionaries and no priests or sisters because of persecution, people were still having their children baptized in secret and taught to the basic extent, because if people knew the importance of baptism, the importance of grace, the importance of their faith, there was a sense of the faith among the people. That's also part of the synod experience. And finally, I'll just mention a word here, a little bit about the process of the synod, if you bear with me. I'll change the image there, and there we have it, the process of the synod itself. And I'm going to just enlarge that just a tiny bit so I can see properly on my screen. You get to a certain age, you know, and your eyes aren't quite as good as they might be in this particular case. But here we have the process. So the 30th of September of this year, there was a prayer vigil, ecumenical, involving people within the church, outside the church, different Christian traditions, and so on and so forth. Then there was a three-day retreat for all of the delegates. And then there was a period of time, the 4th to the 7th of October in red there, where there were talks and witnesses and theological reflections to bring the synod into focus of what they'll be doing. In the blue, you'll see the three priority issues for the synodal church: communion, mission, and participation. Those three categories are the three areas that the delegates focused on in terms of bringing forward, you know, what the church needs to do in terms of moving into the future in the area of communion, in mission, and participation. And a lot of round table discussions occurred and so on. And finally, in the green or turquoise, you'll find conclusions. And that's where summations were given. Papers were written and submitted to the whole plenary about the decisions and discernments that were taken. And from that point has come a synthesis of the synod in October. It is a basic bird's eye view of what was discussed in the synod. And that's available on the website. It's a 40-page synthesis of the synod itself. And so there you have the bird's eye view of the synod. And I just want to share something here with you a bit more, if I could. Just lost my mouse, wherever that is. But I'll just move this forward a little bit. Here we are. Yes. Okay. Yes. And this image here is an interesting one, because on the right, you'll see all of those tables. And that's where the individual discussions, different language groups from around the world, the whole world, are represented there. And then the conclusions from those discussions were given to the plenary of bishops, you'll notice, who met as a group to consider what came forth from those table discussions. A good image of the process of the synod itself. Well, so that's basically a bird's eye view of the synod. I apologize for any glitches in doing that. It's a bit complicated for me, but I think the point got across to you. So, you know, the relationship between our Archdiocesan Synod and the Universal Synod, that is important, that relationship. There's a distinction between the two, and it's good to know the difference between them. So thank you very much. I appreciate that. Today is Immaculate Conception. What I would like to do before Christmas, hopefully in another Friday report, is talk a little bit about the Advent saints, because it's a very interesting subject. But today is the solemnity of the Immaculate Conception, and that's a very important feast day in the church, and very much related to Christmas, of course. The Christ child, the Son of God, and the Mother of God is there with Joseph, the foster father of Jesus, you know, in the manger in Bethlehem. You know, what vessel brought the birth of Jesus into the world? The vessel of the Holy Blessed Virgin Mary. So on December the 8th, 1854, Pope Pius IX, which none of you remember, of course, including myself, he wrote this. It was a formal declaration in the church that in view of the merits of Jesus Christ, the Savior of the human race, what Jesus did for us on the cross, those merits, the Blessed Virgin Mary, in the first instant of her conception, was, by unique grace and privilege of Almighty God, preserved from all stain of original sin. And so that the Lord would be born from the Virgin Mary, the incarnation from a sinless virgin would come into the world, because the Christ child is the Son of God. So that's the formal declaration of the Immaculate Conception. And a long history of belief in the church over a very long period of time. 1854 is in recent history for the church, but belief goes right back to the early church, but it's taken that many years for the church to make that formal declaration. There's many examples in the history of the church where the Immaculate Conception has come to the fore. I think, for example, of Saint Catherine Laboureil, a French religious who was privileged in 1830, before this declaration was even made by the Holy Father. The Blessed Mary appeared to her in the convent several times. Just a remarkable story. And Our Lady asked Saint Catherine to have a medal struck, the miraculous medal, Mary, conceive without sin, pray for us who have recourse to thee, written on that, on the backside of that medal, with 12 stars, the 12 apostles around it. And it was done, only two people knew this was occurring, her spiritual director and confessor and the Mother Superior. And it was kept secret in silence for many, many years before this was made known. And the propagation of the medal, interestingly enough, even during that time, the people of God, the sensus fidelium, the sense of the faith, the people knew that this was an important devotion, and the medal spread throughout the world, all over the place, before this became publicly known and before the declaration of Pius IX about the Immaculate Conception. So the miraculous medal is a powerful and beautiful devotion of the church. And during Advent, the Feast of the Immaculate Conception is a very important feast, because it just indicates to us that Mary is the Mother of God because of the merits of Jesus Christ, who effected that great miracle within her, preserving her from original sin from her conception in the womb of Saint Anne, her mother. Yeah. Mary, pray for us. So the last item, not the last item, but the second to last item for our Friday report, we have launched a new website. And next week, our communications coordinator, Gloria, will talk a little bit, a very short orientation for you on the Friday report about the website, but I encourage you to have a look at it. I think we've brought some improvements to the website of the Archdiocese. It's more visual, easier to get around, and rather attractive. So I commend that to you. Before we close today, I have one question that came forward from a parishioner in the Archdiocese asking about Chenu, or Our Place, the drop-in center that closed recently. And the question was, you know, why did it close? Why did Chenu close? Because many people supported Chenu on Main Street, a drop-in center for street people to come in. And so many people were a little disappointed because of that. Chenu was opened in 1995, I think, by a sister, Jane McDonald, who was a sister of the Holy Cross. She was a remarkable woman. She did a lot of work with the poor people in the inner city, actually. And Chenu, the whole point was, is that for several days a week, it doesn't matter who you are, who you were, what condition you were in, you were welcome to stop by for a cup of coffee, maybe some clothing, maybe some hygienic items that are important, toothpaste and so on and so forth, cup of coffee, fellowship, have a sense of safety and communion off the streets. And this functioned for 28 years, and it served a lot of good, because often some of these people were denied entrance into other drop-in centers or hostels, but they could always drop in at Chenu. Well, over the years, you know, people get older, ill, and they have to withdraw from Chenu, the leadership and so on. And it became increasingly more difficult to find the leadership required to keep the facility going. But also too, quite frankly, the situation on the streets now in the city, unfortunately, it's a bit of a tragedy. They've become less safe and much more difficult. And there's a huge increase in drug usage as well as violence. And it became increasingly difficult for those wonderful people who ran that, who were getting on in years, to maintain that under those conditions. So it was very expedient. And I think we need to be very thankful to Sister Jane McDonald for her heroic vision in opening up the Chenu, and for the many volunteers over the years. I was there many times myself, stopping by. We had one of our listening sessions at Chenu with street people for our Archdiocesan Synod. It was a very interesting experience. But that's the reason why. And those are two reasons why Chenu had to close. But we are very grateful. The church always witnesses these things. Certain things come up and they fade away and something else comes up. So that's the history of our faith. Different initiatives by people who really seek to live out their baptism. So thank you very much, dear friends, for listening today. Following the Friday report, there will be another reflection by Bishop Jan Hansen from Mackenzie Fort Smith. So after the blessing, you'll see a little square on the screen. You just punch that and you'll get an Advent reflection, a 6-minute second week of Advent reflection. Thank you for watching. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless and keep you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.